Indo-European. So, see, this is a very simple, easy question. Lots of Taiwanese learners would have errors in paper, right? And then this is count in now, so you need an S here. And this is in the past tense, so you need to change this verb form. For regular past verb, you have ED. For irregular, then you have to memorize lots of things. That's something very difficult. The first time I taught English after I graduated back in 1975, actually, the director of this institute was my student.
Oh, wow.
And then one of his classmates asked me in class, why are Englishmen so stupid? Yesterday means in the past.
Right.
Why do you need ED? Two here meaning more than one. Mm-hmm. Why do you need S?
Yeah.
But I told them, languages are different. There's bound to be linguistic differences when you pick up another language. Okay. But then I think he was making a good observation there. Okay. But then still, you see, why our students are feeling so frustrated? You have the past tense context, and you still need to have that ED ending there. You have a number here, more than one, and you need to redundantly use the SMB. But this is for English. Okay. So for Taiwanese learners, this is something, one barrier they have to somehow overcome. So that they can
what you're saying there is basically the difference between English and Chinglish.
Right.
Yeah.
English
and Chinglish. So it's like the two problems you just said were the two differences between
good point. Good point. See, for ELF, for English is a lingua franca, a lot of people are saying we should tolerate things like this. Because the meaning is there, right? The meaning is there.
The meaning is there.
I know you're talking about doing something in the past.
Yeah.
And you bought two books.
But if we change English, our English grammar to Chinese, then it doesn't work either. So unfortunately, you're going to learn the difference.
Yeah, but back in our time, teachers are very strict on this. Once you would make errors like this, they would ask you to write 2,000 times the rule. The rule saying if the noun is countable, you need to have an S at the end of the noun in Chinese.
In Chinese.
In Chinese, does that help?
No, it doesn't.
No, it won't help. See, but our teachers made us do that, hoping we can memorize the rules. That was disaster. And you can sympathize why students would lose interest in English, because they are learning rules, nonsense rules. They are not learning the language. That's the whole problem, actually. Okay, so back to the point I want to make. Here is that the mother tongue is different. Why Spanish speakers feel so comfortable learning English? The words are more or less the same, couplets. But think in terms of astrology. The Chinese would be very different. Nothing similar to this. So you can see, we're talking about different mother tongues, different levels of difficulty in learning the target language.
For Chinese, for Mandarin, trying to learn the roots and stuff, do they have roots similar to Latin-based words?
No.
So there's no root structures?
Well, we have morphological roots.
Okay.
But then we have, like, you have base and ball, right? And in Chinese too, we have bang and qiu. So you have bang qiu. But then that's a different kind of combination. The rule is the same, but then it's not as clear to the English language. See, these are EU languages, Indo-European language families. So you see the similarities. You don't have to, not as much effort there as what we have to spend here in order to learn. So I'm showing this simply to tell you that our kids, they happen to be slow. They're slow for a reason, for good reason. Okay, and so this is coming back to the vital the essential elements in learning a language successfully. And there are several I's. Okay? So like you were saying, recycling the use, right? Okay. So several I's, can you make a guess first?
I
where's beginning with I? So to learn a language successfully, you need interest, right? Interest. And I bet you a lot of kids, when they first study English, they have interest. Initially, they have interest. But then later, gradually, because of the test results, they lose interest. Okay. And then you were talking about reading, right? What does reading give you? What does reading give to the
information?
Information.
For us, input is something else. Here, we don't have as much input as you can imagine in your own countries. You grow up speaking English, we grow up speaking our mother tongue, which is very different from English. See the difficulty here? See, one hour every week. What does that mean? Hey parents, if you're rich enough, go get your student, go get your kids to cram school. Otherwise, how do they get input? No input. Okay. Even if you have input, you need also intensity, right? You don't study English for one day, and then for the other 6 days, no English at all. That won't go far. So you need input. You need intensity. That's why we have been proposing that you need to have at least 3 meetings, 30 minutes at least, for the kids to feel interested in English. But here, again, you don't have that. You don't have enough input. You don't have enough intensity. So even if you started out with some interest, you're going to lose the interest gradually. And people have also mentioned to me that if you're talking about I, there's another one, interaction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
For successful learners, they learn English to interact with other people. But here, as I just mentioned, most kids in Taiwan learn English just to pass exams. That's the biggest difference. Okay, so if you have a Taiwanese child, maybe this child goes to the States with his parents. In 2 months' time, this child can speak some English, picking up English.
That's the other I, immersion.
Immersion.
That's unfortunate ones. Yeah.
So lots of things. See, our kids work very hard, but then they don't have all these. And so when we're talking about this one here, this is a 12-year education curriculum guidelines. See, for third and fourth graders, that's 1 meeting every week. For the fifth and sixth graders, 2 meetings every week. That's very, very few input, very little input. Mm-hmm. How do you expect them to make significant progress?
So why is it like this? Why don't you change it?
Because here we have so many things to learn. The law just passed, the national language law, saying that we should respect all languages in Taiwan equally. So that means Hakka. They're going to spend time speaking Hakka,
Southern
mean Aboriginal language.
Yes.
But kids have only 24 hours.
Yes, that's
but they've got the time at home to practice their kojo, or they've got the time to practice their tai.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't have the English access at home, where the other Taiwan dialects at home.
Good point. But then, because of some ideological reasons, they want to put them in the official curriculum. And then later,
well, that's fair. It's a different weight of how much exposure they have to that language.
And then think about the comprehensive exams. How many different languages?
But if they want to see the urgency of this now, why don't they do anything? It's
urgent.
Yeah.
You need to act now.
Yeah.
Do it.
Because the government wants to please everyone.
And
then it will end up pleasing nobody.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then the kids will suffer.
Yeah.
That's the sad of it.
Yeah.
It's a closed door thing.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm simply trying to explain to you why we spent so much effort, but then still there is very few successful cases.
14 years, and we haven't seen a lot of change. Any progress in this country?
Oh, we have some better ones. Actually, if the kids come from rich families,
yes,
they have extra resources.
Yes.
And they are really good.
But I mean, it's right with them.
So, for now, actually, we put our emphasis on this remedial instruction. We're trying to help these smaller learners. Because these are the kids who don't have resources.
And the towns, the smaller towns, that all the foreigners that come here, the worst of which ones, they go to the cities. Nobody wants to work in the rural, small areas.
You were supposed to come to the
yeah.
remote areas, right?
So that's why we
so
need
you're helping
yes.
us. You're helping
yes.
us.
Yes,
it's
I know that.
It's,
when it comes to, you said for 3rd and 4th grade they have one meeting, 5th and 6th they have two meetings.
Yeah.
Is this like actual one-on-one meetings or this?
Oh no, this
class
is whole
class.
Class.
Whole class. Whole
class.
Whole
class. So they only have one class a
yes.
week and two classes a week.
Yeah.
Right.
So they don't have it daily?
No,
of course not.
So you're talking about our class.
Yes, yeah,
right.
Right.
But in English from a Taiwanese teacher, they have daily, correct?
No.
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 No. No.
But
that's
a junior high.
When I worked in Taiwan, I swear they had it more than.
Yes, right. Because your school has some extra 2 hours. But as we call that a flexible class. So basically you only have like a 3 hours teaching and then every school can have their own flexible classes. So that's why you will have 5 hours and that will be daily from Monday to Friday.
We call that experimental schools.
Experimental. Yes. Why wouldn't they have it daily like their other subjects? That doesn't make sense.
I don't think all subjects are daily though, too,
right?
Like Chinese is daily.
Is that Chinese? But
Chinese is daily, but math is also not daily. Math is, math is similar to, yeah, similar to English.
Even if you live in French or something in the West, it's something
today.
Oh, when I was in elementary school, junior high school, and college, all of my foreign language classes were daily.
Yeah,
I learned five days a week, every week, for every year of school.
So you see,
well,
it's
not
every
day,
but once a
day.
So I took
French
Monday,
Tuesday, Wednesday,
Thursday. Yeah, so they can write down their suggestion to our Ministry of Education, right? See, I think it's a good way. Yeah, so you guys can suggest. Write down your suggestion, your opinion.
Aboriginal languages were removed in the past, and now they're back in, and so they're trying to keep it fair and balanced. Because of the discrimination, you were not allowed to learn the Aboriginal language in the past. So that's why, even though they don't have access to us, they're not gonna cut back on those hours because of those past transgressions. So it's like a pot that somebody has to always be there to stir.
Right.
It's not gonna change.
And it also seems to depend on the different parties. Like you said, Chen Shui-bian introduced this program, but the KMT might not have because maybe they were more China friendly.
When we talk about colors, okay? So I mean, it's a strong issue. Talk about colors. So nothing to do with the colors, okay?
Yeah. Okay.
So we talk about colors. At night, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But the point is that you see the complicated picture here. Okay. Kids work hard, but then because of the limitation in input, intensity, whatever, see, we really make very little progress. That's why there are slogans like, let them become better in 3 years' time, but then still.
So is this why, like the fact that the students only have these classes like once or twice a week, is that why the Bushibans have become so big after school?
Yes.
Because it's more immersion of the language.
Right.
Good. And then the next question would be, if the cram schools are teaching English, what do they teach?
Yeah. It's the standard. Some teachers teach English, they can't speak English.
That's what you're
right. They go to cram school, but then they don't get to use English. Mm-hmm. They don't learn to use English. They learn a lot of grammar rules. Useless rules.
But the government should standardize it and say, if you only use these three books of Bushibans, teachers should be regulated, should be more like that. I mean, you know.
Eventually, we got more business to do.
Lina would be happy, okay, if we have to kind of put some requirements on the Bushibans.
Yes.
You showed us some statistics before about the English and what percentage failed. Would you look at statistics between urban and country schools?
In generally speaking, for the outcomes, you were talking about the outcomes thing, right?
As in how many students failed?
City people tend to say we are more or less satisfied.
Yeah.
Okay, because they see the success in their kids.
Right.
And then in the remote areas where little English is practiced, then they will be kind of more reserved.
Yeah.
In terms of whether we're doing a good job.
But the one third of students failing, is that
mostly in remote areas?
Is that island wide?
Yeah.
That's just in urban area or in rural area?
That's island wide. And then the majority. It's in the remote areas.
Especially in Hualien, the school you are going to teach. I'm sorry.
You are going to make a difference.
So Lena Herman is going to make a difference.
Yeah,
okay. Let's give Lena Herman a big hand.
Okay, now I'm just giving you a picture of what you will be teaching, what kind of students you will be teaching and what constraints you have in terms of the teaching. Okay. But I don't want to scare you away because there are still some quite good learners. Okay, so exposure to the English language, actually this is something you need to provide. Okay. So with you around, the kids in your school will be luckier because they will start to talk to you and they will not feel tight or afraid talking to you, and this would help them kind of feel more relaxed.
When I was teaching at junior high in Shinju, I found that my kids learned more from me at 7-Eleven, something that they did in the classroom. They're in a group of friends that they feel comfortable with. They're not embarrassed.
Yes.
And they want to try.
Yeah.
And in a classroom with 15 or 18 or 19 kids, you know, it's you don't know what's going to happen. But you know, you go to 7-Eleven, they want to ask you, what sandwich is that? Or whatever.
Yes.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
But
then
it's really cool, actually. It makes you, because you sometimes leave your classroom and you want, man, what did they do today? What did they learn today? And then did they even like me? I think these kids hate me. And then you go to 7-Eleven.
They come along.
Hello, teacher. Hello.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
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 But just to
add
on
what
you're saying, I feel that it's a hard thing for kids to, because in school, it's very much top-down teaching. You know, they sit and they listen and they write. It's very little communication back and forth. In middle school now, I'm talking about not English, just other subjects. So it's very much kids sit down and it's rote learning most of them.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not used to speaking to their teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a whole new thing that you've got to teach them that it's okay to not say it all together. It's okay for one of them to say their time, and it's okay for them to ask out of turn, like we are doing now. It's very natural for us, but it's very unnatural for them. So it's hard for them to learn how to become that kid that participates in class. I mean, and that's without the English factor in it. That's just it's the teacher-student relationship that they have. Relearn in your class because they're not really used to do that in their regular classroom.
And ask questions because, like when the boss at the meeting, the employees sit there and they listen. They say, does anybody have anything to add? But we go out and they're like, oh, I want to tell the boss this. And we get back to the meeting and
that's
the goal.
Telling what actually is happening here, right? And so your task becomes how do you get them to talk?
Yes, how do you
open
up? Yeah, right, to open up and talk. So 7-Eleven is a good
luckily there's only one. I lived in a one street town, so there's only one 7-Eleven. There's nowhere else to go for them. I can trap them.
Always coming in girls. But the kids are lucky. Right? They get to practice English with you, and they feel relaxed.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
In a classroom situation.
It's fun.
Yeah, right.
In regards to that, for the application of language for our classes, are we constrained only to teaching them inside the classroom, or are we able to leave the school, or are we able to go somewhere? Like a field trip kind of things, can we bring them somewhere and talk to them? Like, hey guys, we're gonna go to 7-Eleven. Let's go and order stuff in English. Let's try to figure this out. Can we go to like a local zoo or something?
You can discuss with your co-teacher and at your school. You can design your own curriculum, your own lesson plan, right? But you two can just talk to your principal or your co-teacher in advance.
Okay.
And they will arrange some field trips so your kids can apply their English in a real situation.
Okay.
Yeah,
so
you can
we
do
are
that.
Able to do that?
Sure.
Sweet. Okay.
Yeah, just talk in advance.
Don't do it every day.
Oh, not every day.
Yeah, not every day, of course. Next.
You say, when you take them out, make sure they're safe.
Yes.
That's
well, the reason I ask that is
for
my school districts, when I was in school, I had a grand total of 3 field trips between third grade and graduation of high school. We never left the classroom, so for a lot of what we were learning, it was just constrained to that classroom. And so going outside of there, that's an option that we can use as
right.
Well.
Right.
That would be expected that you can push for.
Okay.
It's not really going to be a normal thing, but it's something that is possible.
Okay.
But the school might not be used to that staff teaching, but it's something you should push for.
Okay.
Oh, okay, let's take a 10-minute break, okay?
Yes, and Professor, this is